Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for coming to this press conference on the launch of the Travel and Tourism Competitiveness Report 2015. We're very, very pleased to have a distinguished panel at the occasion, composed of three trade ministers from the region and a private sector representative. So we have, allow me to welcome Minister Ruiz Massieu from Mexico, Minister Alvarez Correa Glenn from Colombia, Mr. Jonas Reinhardt, Senior Vice President from Hilton, and Minister Silva from Peru. Thank you for joining us for this occasion. We have 30 minutes of time for this press conference, so I would ask you to be very, very brief in your remarks so that we can allow afterwards for questions and answers from the group and from those of you who are listening also virtually to this webcasted press conference. Thank you. I'll start by introducing very briefly the key findings of the report. It's a report that has been produced by the World Economic Forum since 2007. We have hard copies here available if you're interested. And it looks at four categories, essentially. It has an index at the core. It looks at four categories: enabling environment, the travel and tourism-related policies, infrastructure, and natural cultural resources. So these are the four factors that we assess. And this year, we have four key messages that came out of the analysis. First of all, the first message is that the travel tourism sector has been very resilient over the past years. It has not only weathered well the geopolitical events of the past years, terrorism threats, as well as the slowing economy, but it's also rebounded well from those threats. So this shows a very high level of resilience. We also saw this year that that countries that are better prepared to capture the new trends, such as changing geographical composition of the travelers, moving more towards the emerging market, rising middle classes in the emerging market, but also different preference of travelers, growing importance of online services, etc., are those countries that perform better in the travel and tourism index. What is an important finding for us is that the travel and tourism sector actually is a very important sector for the economy as a whole, but it's also important in terms of backward linkages. So it has a huge development impact. So that's why it's very important for this region, for social inclusion and similar other policy goals. And we see several developing and emerging markets actually in the top 50 of the report, which is quite unusual compared to many of the other assessments that we undertake. And last but not least, any improvements, any changes to the travel and tourism environment and any development of the travel and tourism sector is not just a role of the public sector, right? It cannot be just done by ministers, but it requires a lot of coordination with the private sector, international coordination, collaboration as well, and also across the ministries and different agencies within the country. So it's a complex issue and cannot be done by one single actor alone. Then in terms of the rankings, allow me to give a very few highlights, and you can access the full rankings in the report, and they are also available online. Spain is leading the index for the first time this year, followed by France and Germany, who are the three European best performers. Then we see that in Africa, South Africa is the best performer at 28th, followed by Seychelles and Mauritius. In Asia, we see Australia at 7th, with Japan and Hong Kong at 9th and 13th, respectively. In the Middle East, we see UAE at 24th, and the best North African country is Tunisia at 79th. In this region, Latin America, Brazil is the best performer at 28th, followed by Mexico at 30th position. And maybe I'll stop here with an overview of the rankings, and let me turn to the panel with a few questions about the performance of the countries from this region and that we have present here. So let me start with Mexico, with our host here today. Minister, Mexico has had a very strong performance in this year's Travel and Tourism Competitiveness Report at 30th position. It's a very good result. We see some strengths in terms of cultural natural resources, but also some challenges in terms of safety and security and the business environment as well. And what we also see is that although here in Cancun, most of the tourism, you see it very clearly, most of the tourists really come from either Europe or from the United States. The future growth markets are rather developing countries, the middle classes from the developing countries. How are you planning to capture those new markets from Mexico?
Well, what the report shows is that we have been very successful in tackling some of the issues we've had in the past, mostly in terms of making the most of our attributes that are essential for developing new new services and new types of destinations for today's traveler linked to our natural resources or our cultural heritage. But we also have very large challenges, mostly involving infrastructure. And I say infrastructure linked to your question because we, like everybody else, we're all competing for a larger share of the international market. We are working towards capturing more and more of those emerging markets, but how are we going to receive them? So one of the main findings from this report that that we find especially useful is that we have to work on developing more long-term infrastructure. Infrastructure not only in terms of airport infrastructure, but in terms of the types of accommodations, the type of services such as not only hotels, but commerces, restaurants, that will cater to the needs and expectations of those emerging markets. And in that sense, we have to work in two speeds. One is today, to continue to receive the flows of tourists that we have been receiving at the rate of 20% growth last year and double-digit growth for the first trimester of this year. And we have to continue to innovate, to increase our infrastructure, to generate the possibility, the interest for those tourists to go somewhere else other than the destinations that we already have very well positioned. And on the other hand, we have to work towards what we need to do to ensure that in the next years, those emerging markets will continue to see Mexico as a preferred destination. So new markets, we have to work towards them, but the markets we have a strong presence right now in, we have to continue to do what we have been doing. But the report clearly shows where we have been making progress and where we have big challenges such as infrastructure.
Great, and you're continuing to address them. In the case of Colombia, we see also some challenges. Colombia is ranked 68th this year on this year's Travel and Tourism Index, and you know there are many strengths of the country, but obviously many challenges that you have been addressing over the past year. Colombia is a country that's rebounded from economically and also in terms of the security situation, has repositioned and rebranded itself, a great success story. Still in the index we see that on the safety and security, the position is quite low. So what are your next steps in terms of continuing this work?
Let me address to the audience in Spanish so I can, I prefer to speak Spanish so you can all understand what I can say. Mire, Colombia.
Well, listen, Colombia has been developing a policy towards tourism, which is very important. As it has been stated by our panel member, we have increased our position in 16 points within the ranking, which is something that is pleasing us very much, and we must improve other areas. But let me illustrate you with some Colombian figures, which are very important. Colombia, last year in tourism, we had an increase of 11%, while the global figures had an increase of approximately 4%. And this comes together with a situation which is quite particular, and it has to do with job generation. The tourism sector increased itself considerably in job generation. We went beyond the target of job generation in 190%. Almost 200,000 new jobs were created.
Que con el tema de la paz, que ustedes saben que el presidente ha estado focalizado desde su primer mandato en arreglar la paz en Colombia, que es un conflicto que lleva más de 50 años. Este tema de seguridad lo que va a hacer es, que está unido al tema de la paz, lo que va a hacer es incrementar el turismo. Y también, como lo dijo mi compañera de la Alianza y la ministra de Turismo de México, es importante no solo eso, sino el tema de infraestructura, y Colombia tiene un plan de infraestructura de 26 billones de pesos que va a conectar las carreteras y obviamente el turismo, pero también tiene que en la infraestructura aeroportuaria, Hay un plan de inversión de 3 billones de pesos para intervenir casi 32 aeropuertos en el país, y las cadenas hoteleras internacionales han venido haciendo inversiones considerables en el país. La última inversión que conocida es el Hilton International, va a construir alrededor de 26 hoteles en ciudades intermedias. ¿Se imaginan esto en un sistema donde estamos pues haciendo todos los alcances posibles para obtener?
Perfect segue to move on to Jonas and Jonas Nangert, and to tell us a little bit more about your international experience, your bigger experience that you've gathered investing in different countries, and what are the learnings from this for Latin America? What can Latin America learn from the international experience when developing the travel and tourism sector?
Very good, thank you. So this is a very important report. This is a very important session today. And it's important because the travel and tourism business globally is booming at a rate much faster than the global rate of economic expansion. This has been true for the last several years. It's going to be true this year, and it's going to continue to be true for the foreseeable future. In 2013, we saw 1 billion individuals take trips outside of their home country. That number increased in 2014 by 4.7%. And we expect that rate to continue and even accelerate as time goes on. And this is because in the larger developing countries in the world, such as China, we're seeing a greatly expanding middle class. And these newly affluent people have a desire to go see the world, come to this region, and experience everything that it has to offer. And specific to China, we know that last year, 100 million Chinese took trips outside of China. And we expect that in 5 years, that number will double to 200 million. So that's just a tremendous growth. And all of those people are going to go someplace. And where they go is greatly directed by the policies taken by governments, by the decisions taken by the private sector to develop certain destinations. And it's really a multi-part puzzle in making a tourism destination work. And I think here in the Yucatan, you have an example of a place, that a destination that's a great global destination, where they've done everything right with the infrastructure, in terms of the facilities, the airports, the natural protection of the environment, and a very solid visa policy. And I'll say that for the region, a great statement that I heard earlier this week, the best thing the region can do to attract more tourists is really think regionally. And if you look at the European Union, they are the number one region for tourism. More people go to the European Union from outside than anywhere else in the world. And that's not by accident. They've got a visa policy where if you get a visa from a single European country, you can visit 27 different countries within the European Union. And I know that here in Latin America, some work has been done to develop an agreement to move in that direction. We think that's terrific. It'll enable people to stay longer, see more things, and enjoy more of the region and also spend more while they're here. So regional thinking in terms of visa policy and multi-destination visas for visitors coming in from abroad are a couple things that can be done here.
Thank you. Jonas, indeed a very interesting example of the Schengen visa. And the Pacific Alliance is actually implementing something that's very similar. We have 3 Pacific Alliance country ministers of tourism here. And Minister Silva, what do you expect in terms of the impact of this visa agreement from the Pacific Alliance?
It's great, but let me talk about the report. I mean, it's been, I would like to congratulate you because it's a great job. I mean, you changed methodology, you upgraded the number of countries that we have measured. Out of 141 countries, Peru ranked 58. That's an increase of 15 points over the last year. And our strengths are, it's great because with your 14 indexes, they tell us where are the areas that we need to improve. As we know, Peru's basics are strengths are in nature and cultural. We have Machu Picchu in Cusco. We're proud of that. But we're all working on the diversification of our touristic supply. We have 8 other different touristic circuits that we are exploding, and that also that we need to see that safetiness and security, as well as improving our infrastructure. We have to correct that because we have ranked 118 and 117 positions out of 141. So looking at that, the whole report tell us where, as I said, the policies that we have to implement in order to take advantage of that movement that all over the world is being pushed, people, those 100 million Chinese and obviously Americans and Europeans. In the case of Peru, we received 3.2 million tourists last year. The country by far, I mean, we receive 800,000 Chileans because we have a very important in tourism at the frontier. The second largest country is United States with 400,000. And this year so far, we've been growing 11.5, almost 12% in the first quarter this year. And going back, or let me do the analogy with what tourism and travel and tourism has done to our country. It's not only about receiving, you know, foreigners in our country, but it's letting families, Peruvian families, knowing that to love your country, to be proud of your country, you have to know your country. And that is the magic that tourism does, that connects us with people from other regions, that let us know that no matter what, people always feel proud of their surrounding, of their local communities. And travel and tourism has allowed us, in the case of Peru, we lived a very long history of uncertainty, and as you know, we had a very big terrorism problem that allowed and that didn't allow us to go out and travel and meet people from our own country. So we've developed a tool, it's called ituqueplanes.com, meaning what about you, what are your plans, that is an electronically device that has gathered more than 350 firms that puts promotions and tries to diversify or de-seasonalize the decisions that people take, so that we all not take the same time and travel during our vacations or during the national holidays. We're trying to promote the trips with schools. We're working with communities to put on villages and to move forward on the rural tourism that is bringing up. And going back to the Pacific Alliance, exactly, that's what we've done. The four of us have been working on two promotion packages, taking into account that people are used to do the multi-destiny, they're making decisions on multi-destiny purposes, meaning that Asians or Europeans or even Americans like to know other than one country. In the four countries, we offer different things, you know, from beaches to cultural experiences to gastronomy or natural parks. We all have different things, and the visa step, the elimination of the visa within our countries has done a remarkable increase in the first year of measure. And we're doing the second stage of the Pacific Alliance right now, is to work on third countries. Is that, as you said, we are trying to work and think as a bloc and trying to connect with third countries, meaning that the Pacific Alliance is one global bloc that will attract new investors and new foreigners to come.
Thank you. It's definitely very promising developments for the region. And thank you in particular for keeping it short and sweet so that we can take some questions from the floor. And you have the opportunity now to ask questions also online if it's the case. So please, who would like to ask the first question?
Everything was clear.
Buenas tardes, mi nombre es Adriana Varillas y soy corresponsal del Universal aquí en Quintana Roo. Me gustaría saber cuánto tiempo duró este estudio, cuáles son las los elementos básicos que lo integran y qué se está midiendo en el, y bueno, en el caso de México me gustaría un poquito ahondar más en cómo está saliendo, si ha habido una evolución en algunos aspectos, si existe algún retroceso en otros y los grandes retos, ¿no?, del país. Gracias.
Let me tell you about the report in general. The study was based on data from 2013, 2014, from those 2 years. It's an index that looks at the four areas that I mentioned up front. So one is enabling environment, so all the factors that are in the overall business environment. Then specific travel and tourism policies, so that are in the realm of the country. Infrastructure is an important component, and this includes hard infrastructure, roads, airports, but also tourism infrastructure. And then natural and cultural resources, which are the main reasons for travel. So these are the four components that we take into account, and we can analyze the countries by those different components. I have the results in for Mexico here, if you would like to take a more detailed look. In terms of the comparison with the past years, it is very difficult because we changed the methodology this year, so the comparison with past years are unfortunately not possible, because it would be misleading. Yeah, thank you.
Si quieres en español, bueno, México subió 14 posiciones en el ranking. Este año estamos en el lugar número 30. Y tenemos pues áreas donde somos muy fuertes y que nos dan una gran competitividad, como es todo el tema de los recursos naturales y recursos herencia cultural, que son motivadores de viaje muy, muy importantes. También mejoramos, por ejemplo, en el número de días para empezar un negocio, en el número de salidas o de viajes que se generan por cada 1,000 habitantes, en prácticas laborales de contratación o de movilidad en el sector, por ejemplo. Pero sí se identifican algunas áreas de oportunidad. Una que ya señalé, que es el tema en general de infraestructura no solo de conectividad, como pueden ser aeropuertos, también de movilidad terrestre, sino también de infraestructura de generar nuevos servicios, nuevas instancias de servicios, nuevos hoteles, nuevos comercios, y todo esto pues asociado a la visión de que, como ya se mencionó aquí, los países que más han crecido y que más van a seguir creciendo son los que mejor se adaptan a las tendencias que se identifican. Entonces, esta es una industria que crece, pero es una industria que requiere de innovación constante, que requiere de perfilar estrategias más segmentadas para atender a nichos de mercado específicos, no solo en términos de sus gustos o de sus intereses, sino en términos de demográficos. Los adultos mayores de 60 años que están viajando mucho requieren cierto tipo de servicios y tienen cierto tipo de intereses, y los jóvenes, los millennials, que van a empezar a viajar cada vez más, pues también requieren otras herramientas, y ahí también tenemos una enorme área de oportunidad con la incorporación de las nuevas tecnologías, no solo desde el punto de vista del consumidor o del turista potencial que busca información y que toma decisiones a través de lo que conoce en la red y a través de su teléfono, sino también desde la oferta y desde el gobierno, de cómo transmitimos lo que estamos haciendo y la oferta que estamos teniendo. Entonces, áreas de oportunidad, yo diría que la tecnología, el desarrollo de nuevos servicios y de mayor infraestructura, y sobre todo también de infraestructura de conectividad, pero fuertes en otros sectores que nos han permitido hoy estar en el número 30 del ranking de competitividad.
Thank you. And we have just a little bit of time left. Maybe one more quick question with a very brief answer in the back over there. Or let's take the two and a very brief answer, but very, very briefly, please.
Gracias. Bienvenidos. Welcome. Heidi Juárez, Grupo Imagen Multimedia de aquí de México. En el caso de los países representados, ¿cuál es la estrategia actual que están siguiendo para mejorar la percepción de seguridad del turista y cómo entra en ello la iniciativa privada?
Bueno, en español, porque directamente para responder tu pregunta. En el caso del Perú, nosotros tomamos la iniciativa hace ya 2 años de, con el presupuesto del Ministerio de Comercio Exterior y Turismo, comprar 43 camionetas 4x4 con equipos de seguridad para dárselas al Ministerio del Interior. Pero no solamente eso, sino que firmar un convenio de manera que tienen estrictamente señalizadas las instrucciones para que obviamente esas camionetas, cuando fueron donadas, no terminen estacionadas porque no tienen gasolina o porque no tienen choferes. Estamos, además, nosotros hemos diseñado, hemos comprado el equipo de comunicación para estar interconectados con el Ministerio. Hemos ya lanzado el primer corredor preferencial que sale del aeropuerto Jorge Chávez hasta el último hotel en el distrito de Surco, y estamos implementando siete otras rutas en Cusco, en Nazca, en el Amazonas, para poder nosotros interconectar y desde Lima poder monitorear. En segundo lugar, hemos capacitado a toda la Policía Nacional de Turismo en las clases de inglés a través del propio ministerio, y estamos llevando estadísticas mensuales, ¿no?, diarias, que luego son conversadas primero a nivel interno con la Policía Nacional para poder trabajar en estrecha coordinación. Cuando ellos se han sentido parte de este nuevo sistema, creo que es cuando ha empezado a cambiar un poco la visión que ellos tenían de ser entes aislados y de que, por ser policía de turismo que pertenece a la Policía Nacional, no eran tomados en cuenta como las grandes prioridades. ¿Que tenemos que seguir mejorando? Tenemos. Hoy día el presidente Peña Nieto ha sido muy claro en su alocución, ha dicho que no podemos estar contentos y no podemos quedarnos felices con lo que hemos conseguido. Tenemos que seguir trabajando porque estoy segura que para todos nosotros lo más importante es la seguridad y la vida de las personas.
And I think that's a good example for the region. We'll unfortunately not be able to go through all the countries and to get the response from all the countries. There are many interesting case studies and many interesting initiatives, but unfortunately we're running out of time, so we will we can follow up maybe directly right after the meeting. On your direct questions then, okay? Thank you. Unfortunately, we'll not be able to take it anymore because we're running out of time, but, you know, happy to connect if there are any questions about the report or...
She took all the time, you know.
I'm sorry.
Thank you very much for coming and for participating, and thank you to the distinguished panel that we have here of all ladies ministers. thank you very much.